main motivating factor in most of my musical choices is having gotten bored with the last thing I've done, or seeking something new and interesting that's outside of my immediate musical realm. I think that most true musicians are like that, that they want to feel as excited about music at whatever age they are as they did when they first realized that they could play it, that they could pick up an instrument and, like I did for the very first time, pick out Walk Don't Run on the guitar and suddenly realize I have the power of music now. And you want to feel that way even if you're 80. So the idea, this constant evolution and movement in music is sort of built into the way I see the career. I've been touring on and off more or less continuously for 40 years now. And I consider myself fortunate to still have a career in music when so many people have essentially fallen by the wayside, or maybe they still have a career in music, but that career is playing the same song every night for the rest of that career. And for me, that's being an entertainer, but it's not being a musician. And I still have the chutzpah to think of myself as both, that I'm a musician who can entertain. And now that I'm 60, I figure I probably am going to stick with it.
We'll be right back. Thank you, Coloradans. I acknowledge every time I come here, this is close to Shangri-La as we're getting in the continental United States. I've never seen so many Tibetan clothing stores in frickin' Kathmandu. Let me hip you to the evening's proceedings. We're gonna play a few more familiar tunes. And then we're going into really dark territory, people. We're gonna play, I'll tell you what we'll play before we play it.
Thank you.
Neither of my parents were actually instrumentalists, although my father owned a guitar that he picked up when he was in the military. But it sat in the basement gathering dust. He never played it. And one day I kind of decided I was going to try and tune it up. And I had some tuning in my own head that wasn't really guitar tuning. And I couldn't, my little fingers couldn't make the machines move. So I took a pair of pliers and eventually snapped the head off of the guitar trying to tune it up to like violin tuning or something. And that made him a little bit perturbed, but I pestered and pestered until they finally got me a guitar and some guitar lessons when I was about six, I guess. And after 2 months of guitar lessons, I said, the heck with that. I could pick out any song that they wanted me to play. But the subsequent consequence of that was that I don't know how to read music to this day. I probably should have taken a few more lessons. I found myself in the 70s actually with three so-called hats. I actually first, when I left my original band, the Naz, the only thing I wanted to do was make records with other people. And so I became a producer engineer, started making records with a lot of acts, and then I started to miss making my own music, even though I had never been a solo artist before. I thought, well, at least I can go into the studio and make music. I don't have any intention of going out on the road and playing it. And I made my first solo record, and ironically enough, it had a hit song on it called We Gotta Get Your Woman. And then I was sort of forced into becoming a regular touring artist. So then I had two careers. I had production and I had my work as a soloist. But my work as a soloist also didn't allow me to do some of the things that I wanted to do regarding playing and things like that. I was doing a solo album called A Wizard, A True Star, and I've been working with a group of musicians who did most of the playing on the record. And by the time we got to the end of it, I thought, why don't I make this into a band? And the band was playing what had currently become popular. It was called Fusion. So then I had three different things, three different kinds of media of expression, and three different more or less income streams, I suppose. So I wasn't forced to do any one of them. I didn't have to be a truly successful solo artist because I had production to fall back on. Utopia didn't have to be a fully successful band because, again, I had other things to do. And then I went back to being a solo artist, and that's what I am now. Even though I tour with the band, the personnel in the band may change at certain points, and we play my music.
I knew it, there was something wrong.
Guess the names of those last two songs. One was called Afraid and one was called Mad. Explain to your neighbor if necessary which was which.
Ready? One, two, one.
Crown my head, open it up, never be forced to fade. you.
Well, the show that we're doing now has a central core to it that is the latest album, Arena, performed in its entirety. And we try and bracket that with some material that the audience is familiar with and that they enjoy, and that also helps to set the tone for the evening. So we're at a little bit of a midway point here, where I think that the people who have heard the record are now starting to understand it and say, like, I've heard it once now, and I remember some of it, but I couldn't really absolutely describe it to somebody who hasn't heard it yet. So any moment now, the electronic distribution of the record will come out, and then people will start to recognize some of the songs, like, as I say, like Strike, like Mountaintop, which is supposed to be like a sports anthem, and the couple of ballads that we do, like a song called Weakness, which is, starts out like a really nasty sounding blues song and turns into a very pretty R&B song at the end. So we're not hopefully leaving anybody totally behind. You know, we're leveraging the fact that we have gotten a response from people playing some of the old guitar songs. Now we're going to see how they respond to a lot of new guitar songs.
Thank you.
chair. Did you ever stop to wonder, does anybody care?
Sky, the sky, You are some fist bumping SOBs. Loving it.
When I was in about probably 8th or 9th grade, the English invasion happened, in principle the Beatles were discovered by America, and then everything English suddenly became popular. And the model, the template that they had, which so many bands had, was two guitars, bass, and drums. It was a very accessible and portable kind of a setup. And so music used to be just before the Beatles, used to be sort of a utility. Kids would go to a bar on the Jersey Shore during the summer, and there'd be a band that would play standards. They'd never play original material. They would just play records that people knew already, and kids would dance, and that was it. And then suddenly when the Beatles came about, nobody was dancing anymore. They were all just staring and screaming and, you know, focused completely on the original works of these four guys. So it opened up a whole new world, not just for me, but for lots and lots of people. And I was lucky enough to continue to be able to make music.
Oh, thank you.
I've always got a lot of enjoyment out of the exposure that comes with working with artists who don't do the same kind of music that you do. There are certainly limitations. I don't think I have the aptitude or the desire to do a contemporary country record, but I've worked with a lot of people whose prospects were very doubtful when they got into the studio. You know, people thought, for instance, when we were doing Meatloaf, they thought, who's going to want to listen to this big fat guy sing? And I did the album Bad Out of Hell principally because I thought it was a spoof of Bruce Springsteen. And so in my mind, we were doing kind of a parody. Fortunately, nobody else got the joke, and Bad Out of Hell became one of the greatest sellers of all time. So there are all kinds of rewards to come from producing other people. Sometimes they're financial, and sometimes they're artistic, and sometimes they're just for the entertainment of it, you know, for the enjoyment of working with a band that's really good. You know, to be around other musicians who play really well is always just a lot of fun for a musician.
You
to me, my friend, what you will not defend, somebody else will end up taking. And when the famine comes, think they'll just give you some. But if you believe that, you're mistaken.
Down, and just
Seagrass!